So we have a class discussion of a case, and the case is about Rai Bahadur Mohan Singh Oberoi, who was one of the greatest hoteliers of our age, and he's built up a huge chain of hotels of very high quality, starting from scratch. Started life as a clerk in a hotel, and then within his own lifetime, he built up a great empire. But apart from building the hotel, you see, he was a great leader of people. And today's discussion will focus around his leadership qualities. What is it in him that made building this empire possible? Okay? Before we go to that, we will talk of some issues of leadership, which help in building empires, institutions, and so on. Okay? You have heard of a term called emotional intelligence? It's called EQ, and often it is contrasted with IQ. So, IQ is a measure for a person's intelligence. And is EQ a measure for his emotions?
It's the measure of.
Or is it?
Emotion plus intelligence, all person behaves are different in different circumstances.
Hmm. So, what is the importance of EQ?
So, it shows the amount of. It's a measure of empathy which a person has.
Empathy which a person has.
The small
person has an ability to empathize with another person, but per se you don't possess empathy, right? What is empathy? It is a quality of seeing, right, or being sensitive to the needs and feelings of others. That is empathy.
Feeling like
him. That's right. Projecting yourself into his mind and trying to see how he would look at things. So that is the ability to be able to empathize with people. That is, come to the same vibes. You know, you can look at it, at things the way he looks at it. But EQ, you see, people experience emotions. You have learnt about emotions? Emotions are very strong feelings. And emotions are feelings, right, which are directed usually at someone. Can you give me an example when you express emotion or you experience emotion? I am making the submission that emotions are directive to either a person or a thing or an incident or an episode. Emotions are aroused, they are triggered off by some episode or some person or some event. Example?
Happiness.
Right. So it was triggered off by an episode, the winning of some match.
So any results?
Any results which is announced. You get a promotion, you feel happy. Right? So you have various emotions, you know. You have joy and you have happiness, you have anger, you have sorrow, and you have excitement and so on. And these come out when it's triggered. And usually it is of high intensity. It's something which is manifested, so people around you can make out that feeling. What is mood on the other hand? We also talk of mood.
Mood is internal from inside.
Emotion is also from inside, they're not from outside.
The stimulus is from outside. Some events.
Okay.
Someone else who is giving a stimulus.
Alright. And you are saying mood is just self-generated.
Self-generated.
Without any dependence on any external factor. Say you say you are feeling in a romantic mood. Doesn't any external factor have to do with it? Anything to do with it?
Yeah.
Moonlight, beautiful scenery, someone nice with you.
Even the environment plays its role in
the mood. See, normally a mood is not triggered off by anything. It's a general feeling. And you cannot pinpoint a specific cause for it.
Also,
Pardon me?
So the span of
the time.
Yes.
Over which the mood is there, sir. That's more than emotions.
Exactly.
Emotion can be, sir, very temporary.
It'll be a short burst, maybe short
okay.
amount of time. The mood
okay. Okay. Right. So moods are less intense feelings which convey a certain state of emotions, but not in any particular context. That is also important. So now we have intelligence, and there are various tests and instruments to try and measure your intelligence, all right. We also have got emotions, and we have a combination called emotional intelligence. And this is a combination of skills and capabilities, essentially. Skills and capabilities which we can draw upon. So it's in our armory, so to say. We can draw upon it in order to cope with number of demands and pressures. And that is why in the organization context, it is so important. Because in organizational life, when you come to work, you have to cope with a lot of demands on your time, on your intellectual abilities, emotional abilities. And we say someone is very mature. What do we mean by that? That means he is able to cope, right? Probably he doesn't lose his temper, he doesn't panic, doesn't lose his cool. So when we try to express what we feel about a person, we say he's immature. We are trying to express a basket of things. And one way to do it is say it's a combination of skills and capabilities which we can draw upon to cope with all types of demands and pressures of the job, relationships and environment. And studies have tried to classify what are these components which make up this emotional intelligence. And here are some broad capabilities and abilities, and like self-awareness. So if you have self-awareness in good measure, then that is manifested by self-confidence. If you see someone who's self-confidence, you can deduce that he has a strong awareness of his self. Okay? Realistic self-assessment, self-deprecating sense of manner. What does that mean? Self-deprecating sense of manner. What is self-deprecating?
Making fun of yourself.
No, not really. Not making fun, but playing it down. It reflects that you are not, you don't want to boast about it. When you say he is a self-deprecating person, that means he tries to take everything on a very low, even keel. Even if he has exceptional abilities, he is not very proud of it. He is not arrogant. He doesn't want to boast about it. So even if he is very humorous, all right, he doesn't say that he is very humorous. He plays down his abilities. And that is one of the ways it manifests itself, good self-awareness. Self-management, what is it? Manifested by integrity, trustworthiness, comfort with ambiguity and openness to change. What is comfort with ambiguity?
When things are not very clear,
You still feel comfortable. You don't feel uneasy when something cannot be explained, it's not clear. Are there people like that? See, essentially the human being, we like to have clear-cut answers. Anything that you don't understand, okay, it gives you a feeling of dis-ease or uneasiness. Right? Ambiguity. Openness to change. This is a very important ability. To be open to change, because all of us have fixed views, we have fixed opinions, and sometimes they are quite rigid. Whenever a contrary opinion is expressed, we like to oppose it. That's the first reaction. So if you have an ability where you are open, all right, to change, then that is one of the hallmarks of having the emotional intelligence. Okay? So, there are three other traits which have been classified, or three other capabilities. So, self-awareness. It's repeated. Sorry. Yes. So empathy. We discussed about it manifested by expertise in building and retaining talent. If you empathize or have the ability to empathize with someone, how does it manifest itself? If you can empathize with someone, then you probably have the ability, all right, of retaining talent. Very often it happens, people who are under you in a company, they are not very happy, and it's not uncommon they come and say they want to leave, they have got another job. There are some managers and leaders who are able to talk people out of it in a sincere manner. So this is one of the capabilities where you are able to empathize and you build credibility and trust. And this is one of the capabilities or abilities for emotional intelligence. And social skills. Social skills manifested by the ability to lead change efforts, persuasiveness and expertise in building and leading teams, and the ability to handle the emotions of others. Any comments on this? This is also a rare ability. If you can handle others' emotions, then you emerge as a leader within a group, particularly if it's a conflicting group. People are very opposed to each other. There are violent disagreements. And if within that you have the ability, right, to handle the emotions of others, calm them down, bring them back to the issue at point, then this is your demonstration of your own emotional intelligence. And that is why nowadays the belief is that IQ is less predictive of leaders emerging than the EQ. IQ, they say, is necessary. To be able to lead, you require to be intelligent. But that's not all. That is not sufficient. You need to have EQ also to be able to ultimately emerge in leadership roles and positions during your career. Any questions? All this we are discussing as a precursor to the case which we are going to discuss. That is Rai Bahadur, Mohan Singh Oberoi. Research has shown that there is a high correlation between emotional intelligence and high performance. Leader trait research shows that leaders need basic intelligence and job related knowledge. However, IQ and job knowledge, that is, you can call it technical skills, are threshold capabilities. That is, they are necessary but not sufficient. And you want something more, and it is that emotional intelligence, more than IQ, expertise or any other single factor, that is the best predictor of who will emerge as a leader. Okay? Any questions? Right. Let me pose you a question then. What is the difference between a team and a group?
Team is with a purpose.
Team is with a purpose, and group is also without, with a purpose, or no?
Need not
be. Example? Give an example. What is a team and what is a group? To illustrate what you just said.
A group of people in a railway compartment.
Okay.
It's a team.
Team of
a cricket team.
So. Can you try and differentiate and say, what is it that…
Degree of coherence is more.
That means there is a common bond, maybe because of a common focus. Okay, what else?
Common objective.
Common objective. That's what gives them the coherence. What else?
So the end result is always productive.
End result is always productive. Yes?
Division of labor.
Division of labor. I think… It is more productive than the sum of its constituent parts. When you talk of team efforts, usually you talk of a synergistic kind of an effort. That is, each has its own part to play. The best example is in a cricket team or a hockey team or whatever. But the sum of the parts which each individual plays, all right, is really less than the total output that you get if they play together and they play as a team. So therefore, team connotes some group which is active and actively focused for doing some job for some outcome or objective of goal. Okay. Now, where does the role of the leader come in there? See, immediately when you define it that way, the leadership role is downplayed, is it not? It's basically the team members who are doing the interaction among themselves, focusing on a goal and delivering an outcome which is synergistic. So then what is the difference if you don't have a leader at all? Or is there a need for a leader in such teams?
It's a leader who is to guide the team.
Guide the team. So guiding. So if we have team, we have a team concept of work. Okay? So you have members. Etc. And leader, we are trying to say what is his role, if any. So one we say is guiding, that is showing a way, showing a direction, but not actively participating or dictating or deciding. Could he do that? Issue orders and so on? Huh? So directing. Organizing, motivate. So, if you have a manager here, all right, does he have the same roles exactly or no? Manager is supposed to direct, plan, coordinate, organize. He also has to motivate. So, so my submission is, nowadays as businesses get complex, there is a lot of competition, change is very fast, there is more and more need to organize work by means of teams and not your classical concept of groups formed into departments, you know, either by specialization or by a task orientation like a task force. There is more and more need to work through teams. So, team leadership, new shift in managing work and people is through teams as distinct from the department working as a group. Okay? The distinguishing feature is that teams create synergy through its members' joint efforts. In a group, you can have an accounts department, it's a department, consists of a group of people. They do have a goal also. All right, but essentially, each has the allotted task, each member, and they do it independently. Here the concept is joint, and again I say best is a athletic example, that is a game, a team towards a common objective. And now it says the leader's role is more facilitative and less directive. So he is there not in the middle actively trying to guide his team and directing and organizing and so on, ordering around. He is somewhere on the sidelines. He is observing his team, yes, maybe guiding, maybe coaching a little bit, maybe giving some help where help is needed, but essentially leaving it to the team to take the decision or accomplish the task. We had a kind of group meeting or seminar or workshop yesterday evening, you remember? That was a problem solving. And what was the approach there or the faculty? Was it a facilitative approach or essentially trying to get the students to work out And that success succeeded because the final settlement that came, it was not suggested by the faculty or directed, right or wrong?
Right.
So, that is an immediate example I can think of. Yesterday, the faculty's role was to guide, right, to help wherever possible, all right, but not to take the decision. It was not a decision making role. So, when you are a team leader nowadays, more and more the manager has to look at himself as a team leader and not a manager in the classical sense of managing people. So, this whole concept of command control, that is, you have a boss, essentially the boss gives the task, the subordinates do it. That is giving place to this whole idea of letting people do the work, because that is the way they achieve synergy. Then you give potential, you know, for each one to contribute instead of contributing to whatever maximum he can, innovation, creativity. Because the fact of the matter is, once you start a situation where everything is told by the boss, you build up a dependency culture. Essentially, then the interaction is one of dependence. There is a problem, you push it upwards to the boss, expect a solution. At best, you can go to the boss with two or three options, but still you expect some decision to be given, and here it is totally different. You expect that you will work out a decision yourself. Boss is there, he won't veto it also. He will help you. You have to judge whether you have succeeded or not succeeded. Any questions, comments or observations? It is happening. They are researching it. It is particularly happening in organic type of organization, in IT industries and industries which are very short duration. Garment, fashion garments is a very good example. The advertising, you know, all these TV channels that you have programmed, all these creative programs which are made, these companies are not chain of command, command control kind of companies. You have the people with various skills, you know, you have the copywriter and the director and the cameraman, and they all work amongst themselves. So, research also shows that about 30% of managers, when required to change from the classical approach of management, that is the command control kind of management, they are unable to do it. So, an organization's point of view is such people become dead wood, because they can't change. And when the environment has changed into one of uncertainty, which requires, you know, for success very fast and nimble operations, okay, and it requires managers to become more facilitators. There are people about 30% who can't, or 15% who can't do it, 10 to 15%. And why can't they do it? Because they are a domineering and dominant personality type, it's difficult for them to change, particularly if they are senior managers, because the motivation to change also is less. If it is relatively junior, there is a powerful motivation, there is a need to make a career, to succeed. If it is a relatively older manager, not only the style is ingrained in his personality type, if he is, or the motivation is not there, or both. And then there are 10-15% who readily can adapt themselves. And in between, you have about 65-70% who can be trained, and that is where the management of organization is zeroing. They can train them actually, and then change the culture of management team, the management cadre, in more and more adopting into the facilitative kind of mode. In the factory setting, you can see it all the time, the older managers, and particularly in relation to blue collar workmen, because factory was a place, the domain, where the command control kind of management was very, very predominant. The moment you come into the white collar, that is the office, culturally the office has never had that strong command control as you have had in the factories. And the first phenomenon of militant trade unionism when it started, then this was something which many managers could not cope with. They were used to giving orders which would be followed, and here was the independent power base could not accept the orders. They could not adapt themselves. And of course, if you cannot adapt, then like the dinosaur, you die, isn't it? So even if they had been very loyal managers and so on, of necessity, the top management of the company had to give them sinecure jobs, put them aside, bring people who could adapt to the new dispensation of trying to work with unions, change union, educate union, get your outcomes. All right? So, therefore, team leadership is moving away from command control style of providing leadership. In the organizational context, the need for rapid organization change to keep pace with the fast changing environment and the imperatives of squeezing more output of productivity from your resources which you deploy is powering, that should read as is. Is powering the shift towards team leadership style. A majority of managers can be taught and trained to change to this type of team leadership. Right. Now we come to the training part. If you were to train, what do you go by? This is some of the classification of the team leadership. Studies reveal that there are common responsibilities for assuming team leadership. So, you have to have the responsibility of coaching, facilitating, handling disciplinary problems, reviewing team and individual performance, training and communication. Now, mind you, many of these are also the roles of a manager, are they not? Yes or no?
Yes.
But the style is different. The learning points for team leader style is patience to share information. Now, the moment you go to a facilitative mode, don't you have to share information to try and give rationale for various courses of action which are open to solve a problem instead of you dictating one? That is the facilitation and guiding. To trust others, unless you trust others, how do you allow them to take the decision on their own? To give up authority. Now, this is the most difficult thing to do. Which of us can cross our heart and honestly say that we would like to give up our authority? Okay, we may say it, but we won't do it. What, Viraj?
Yes, sir.
When will we give it up? Under what conditions? If we know and if we are convinced that by so doing, it will be in our interest. Maybe each of us as a manager has got tasks, targets. Don't you think if we find that with this team approach, it works better than the command control approach, then there's a powerful motivation for us to adopt a team type of approach, is it not? But as in all things, this is situational also. If you have people under you And you are in an industry which is a knowledge industry. You have educated people who have the basic wherewithal and the ability to take decisions by examining various options and alternatives, bringing to bear the knowledge required for the solutions. Then the conditions are ideal for you to take more a team leadership role. But in the case of a, let us say, a large workshop where you have low skill jobs, where the education level is lower, the knowledge level is lower, okay, it may not be that easy to expect people under you to solve problems. But then it all depends. There is one school of thought which says that even the less skilled people, the repetitive jobs they are doing, how to do it better, they know better than you do, because they are doing it day in and day out. And many of the valuable suggestions come from the people at that level. So, a team leader's job, therefore, is to focus on two broad priorities. One is external boundary and facilitating the team process. External boundary, I think, is very easy to understand, because as a leader, you are supposed to interface and provide resources which are external, right? And facilitating team process is the more difficult. You would like to jump in, issue an order and do it your way, but you can't. You have to be patient. Ah, for instance, this case we were discussing with you yesterday, it took a long time, didn't it? It took about 2 months to do it, with two meetings. So, these two broad priorities can be translated into four specific roles of the team leader. Liaison with external constituencies. They also include your own management, but upper management, because they are the guys who control the resources. So, if the team wants resources, then it is the team leader's job to go and get the resources from the upper management. Other internal teams. There is interdependency in an organization between the various departments. So, if you want inputs which are scarce and you have to get it from other departments, then it is a team leader's role to go and negotiate with the other departments and get the resource. Then again, external customer suppliers, depending on which department you are leading. Second role is troubleshooters, help in resolving problems, non-technical and non-operational. Why non-technical and non-operational? Because your role is facilitative now. You are not to get into the nitty-gritty of solving what you do in your traditional managerial role. You want your people, your team to solve it. So, you take a distance, all right? And you help resolving problem by facilitating. One of the ways of facilitating is there are issues where people have different stand, to ask some questions which are appropriate, to bring some clarity to the issue. That is your role. So, that will facilitate the problem solving process. So, conflict managers. One is trouble, which is more problem oriented. Conflict is more personality oriented, is it not? It usually arises out of personality conflicts. And so, facilitate and mediate in the resolution. You got to be some kind of arbitrator. That is the role. And coaches, clarify expectations and roles, teach, offer support and help the team members to improve their performance. So, slowly it is more and more coming like an instructor's role, you know, and teaching in a teacher's. Is it not coming more like a teacher's role? Huh? Not a doer. Teacher's role also. I mean, teacher doesn't study and give the exams and pass the exams. No, it trans-facilitates the learning process. Okay? But at the same time, they also do some appraisal, like we said. You have to do appraisal also. That's the role which you cannot abdicate. And last one issue which we want to touch upon is moral leadership. Question of morals keep popping up and up everywhere, isn't it? Moral or ethical. And here it makes the point, the means that a leader uses to achieve the goal, are they ethical? So there's always a debate, you know, whether the end justifies the means or the means justify the end. So in every business decision also, this will keep cropping up. And today, more than in yesteryears, it has assumed lot of importance for the company, because you have an aware citizenry, aware public, you have a lot of consumer legislation. Okay. The content of the goal itself is ethical. That is, every organization has a mission, a vision, a goal, isn't it? So your very vision, is it an ethical thing or not? For instance, if you are in the business of ivory trading. Now, in order to do successful ivory trading, what do you have to do? You have to get the ivory, no? So how do you get the ivory? So killing the elephant. If you could get the ivory without killing the elephant, that's one issue. But without killing, if you can't get the ivory, but you are still in the business, isn't there a moral issue involved here, an ethical issue? You are very content of the goal itself. Tobacco companies, is there, what is their business? To sell as many cigarettes and tobacco, chewing tobacco. If you find that there is a clear relationship or even unclear relationship between smoking or chewing tobacco and cancer, then what is the content of your basic business goal? Is there an ethical issue involved there? So, think about it. The changes that the leader seeks for the organization and its people, and the means employed for the change, are they morally acceptable? Two things: the changes that the leader seeks for the organization, and the means in which to use it. You see, every company, in some way or the other, they try to control behavior of their employees, yes or no, isn't it? But then there are ethical issues involved. Up to how much do you control? Say, the organization say you can't get married until you are 40 years old. Would you say that is a control which goes beyond the threshold? Much beyond. So I am just giving example. You may say it impinges on your basic primary freedom. That's a control which is abhorrent control. But if they say, like in the old days, the tea planters, you know, they passed senior Cambridge and they got a job as assistant manager in the tea garden of Assam. And they were just about, you know, 16 or 17, that was the age. And the rule was there, till you are 25 or something, you can't get married. In the army also you have it. There's an age, you are after which you can marry. But it's a reasonable age, it's acceptable. So you would say there are no moral or ethical issues involved. There may be companies which more go towards the cult, you know, idealization of the leader, the great leader or something. You have to wear a chain round your neck with the photograph of that person. I'm just dramatizing it. But in order to control up to a point is good. But when you control your employees, when you try and change your employees' point of view beyond a certain threshold, then ethical and moral issues are involved. And you as manager and future leaders, you know, you have to be sensitized and aware of this. Every time you have to ask this question, it should be at the back of your mind. Okay. Any questions? All right. If there are no questions, then yeah.
There is a problem with varying culture also. I mean, if a leader in India directs a female employee on the code of conduct as far as dress is concerned, the same dress may not be a problem in the same organization in foreign location.
Yes.
But given the Indian context.
Yeah.
So this creates a problem with the employee.
Sure.
Sure.
In fact, there was a lot of protests, I remember, in Maharashtra, when the police women, you know, they were asked to wear the same uniform as the men, you know, because earlier they were wearing salwar kameez. They were asked to wear, you know, shirts and trousers, and there was a lot of protest which happened, because it was felt that is not an acceptable sort of thing to do. All right. So, now, there are a few questions which I put down here, which you may try and address. And one way to do it in a logical manner is, let's have three groups who discusses on each of these three, all right? So, can we just divide into three groups? If some people will kindly come in front, one group stays there at the back, one group is here. This group is too weak. You can have few more people here on this side. Come, Viraj, you will bring a lot of strength here into this group. Vikas, come here, you are a strong man, strong personality, come. Come, few people come here. Separate, keep one line free so that I know which group. I think Srivats, your line, I have to bother you, just get up. Either come forward or at the back. Right. So now we have the three distinct groups. Okay.